If you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to be in 1 Peter this morning, chapter 4, and we're going to look at the 19 verses there. And I want you to know the writer is Peter, one of the disciples of the Lord. Now, Peter lived in a time where persecution was all around. Matter of fact, this church, the born-again believers, suffered many persecutions. It came from the government, it came from religious leaders, and it came from individuals. So if these saints of old faced persecution, don't you and I today think that we will also face persecution, if not already? If you're not being persecuted, then friend, the devil already has you. Because those who trust Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will face persecution. So let's look what Peter says here in the Gospel of 1 Peter chapter 4. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, he said, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Now, Peter reminds his readers here that, hey, Jesus suffered. He was in the flesh. He came to the earth, walked here just like you and I, and he suffered many persecutions along life's journey. So he said, arm yourself with the same mind that Christ had. So I began to think, what mind did Christ have when he was faced with persecutions and trials here on earth? He had the mindset that he came with, and that was to do the will of the Father. Who you and I, who claim the name of Christ, should be in the same like mind, that we want to please God with our lives, with everything that we do or say. It will bring honor and glory to him. The same mind that Christ had. Then he goes on, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to lust of men, but to the will of God. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles when we walk in the lascivious lusts, excesses of wine, revilings, and quittings, and abominable adultery. Wherein that they think it strange that he run not with them to the same excess of riots and speaking evil of you. And what I gather from that is that when Christ comes into a person's life, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. He don't run with the same old crowd that he used to run with. And that's what he's saying here. He's not hanging out with the same crowd that God delivered him from. He's not doing the same thing that he was doing. He's not lying, cheating, and drinking, and the list goes on and on. You know the list. That person has become a changed individual. And now the old crowd is looking at him and saying, something has happened. He's not the same old person that he used to be. He's not running around with us any longer. That's because Christ has separated him from the crowd of the world. And he said, this crowd that you no longer run with will speak evil of you. Who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? For this cause was the gospel preached also to them, that they are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. The same gospel that saved you will save them, he said. The same gospel, Jesus Christ, amen, who loved them and loved you, can save anybody who calls upon the name of the Lord. But the end of all things, he said, is at hand. Now, how many of you believe we are living in the end time? Matter of fact, amen, that end time began as Christ's resurrection. And the end, amen, is even closer now than when Peter was speaking. But the end is of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us to pray about everything. Matter of fact, Jesus said men always ought to pray and not to faint or give up hope. Amen. Luke 18:1. Above all things, have a fervent charity among yourself, a love, for love shall cover the multitude of sin. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as is of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified. Through Jesus Christ, to him be praise, dominion forever and ever. Amen. See, whenever we should witness, or rather we speak, praise him, God, through song or whatever we do it not for our glory, but for his glory. His glory. Beloved, think it not strange, and this is where we're going to come to today. So listen very carefully. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing is happening to you. Peter is warning the believers here, hey, watch out. Persecution is coming. Trials are coming. Persecution is coming. Don't think it's strange that these things are coming upon you. Don't let it surprise you, in other words. Persecution is coming. Then he says, look at this, but rejoice in so much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, he may be glad also with exceedingly joy. That is something, amen, that we should take into account here. Persecution brings about joy in the believer's heart. Joy. So you hang on with me. You got that now, amen? Persecution is coming, so don't think it's strange. As a matter of fact, he said they're going to be fiery. Fiery. How many of you ever started a fire? Have you ever had a fire to get away from you? Huh? Yeah, fire. Fire's hot, isn't it? Get too close, it's going to hurt, isn't it? Because it's going to burn. So he says, with all of these fiery trials comes joy. And then he goes on, if he be reproached for the name of Christ, he says, happy are he. For the spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On that part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he's glorified. Did y'all catch it? Y'all done fell asleep. Y'all gonna miss the important parts here in just a minute. You know, fell asleep. These are very important words we need to take to heart. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or as a thief or as an evildoer or a busybody. You know what that is? That's a person who got his tongue loose on both ends and flapping in the middle. Hello? Listen, a busybody in other men's matters, that nosy individual. Nosy individual. Yeah. Yet, if any man suffered as Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begins at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scale is to be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. Have you ever wondered, why would God allow trials to come into my life? Why would he allow persecution to take part on the believer's life? Have you ever wondered that? You ever wonder, why am I going through all of this? Why is this happening to me? Has anybody ever questioned that? Why is this happening to me? Why can't it happen to somebody else besides me? I try to live the best life I can live. and all of these troubles are coming my way. I believe every thoughtful person in here today has wondered and pondered that question over and over as time progresses through life. Because, see, you don't have to live very long before that question will stare you in the face. What do you mean, preacher? Well, I just want to tell you. Have you ever faced illness, a critical illness? A death of a loved one? A loss of a job? A breakup of marriage? Trouble with your children? How about a season of depression? Am I talking to somebody today? How about financial difficulties? A time of intense persecution by others who talk about you, run you down, and say lies about you. You been there? It don't take long for these things to start, amen, coming one by one into your life. And if you hadn't faced any of them, get ready, they're coming. Think it not strange. Listen to this again. Think it not strange, beloved. Think it not strange. In the verse 12, look at it. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trials that is coming your way. Don't be surprised when they come knocking at your door. With that said, and with that thought, I began to look in the scriptures to find out the answer to that question. Why does God send trials into my life? Why does he send them into our lives? And when you turn to the Bible to find that answer, you might find many perspectives. I did. But I wanted to stay within this book that we've been studying on Wednesday night. So I wanted to see what Peter's perspective was on these fiery trials that were going to come. Remember, I said, don't think it's strange when they come. They're going to come knocking at your door. Many of those that I've just read off, they're going to come if they're not already upon your doorstep. So what are we going to do? We're going to look at it from God's perspective. In 1 Peter, in chapter 1, in verse 6 and 7, he states these words, wherein he greatly rejoiced, though now for a season. If need be, he are in heaviness through manifold temptations. Is that what he's saying? Somebody help me. Want to make sure you're still awake. Hang on with me. I got some good stuff here. And you know, I always like good stuff, don't you? That'll help me understand life. Peter said, wherein he greatly rejoiced, now for a season, if need be, he are in the heaviness through manifold temptation. Isn't it amazing that when you're young, you don't recognize all these things I'm talking about this morning? They don't affect you or bother you. But as time progresses, as we get older, mature, these things, you know, kind of stares us in the face real quick, doesn't it? And he said, you rejoice for a little while, but all of a sudden now you're in the heaviness of temptations. Things are one right after another. But notice what he said here. They're only for a season. Man, summertime went by quick, didn't it? It was just a season. It's gone. Autumn, fall is here upon us. That will only last for a brief time. Then winter comes in. Life goes in the same cycles. It's just for a moment. It's just for a brief moment. He says these trials and temptations will come upon you. But notice what verse 7 says. that the trials of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, might be found where? Unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. So he says, everything is done for a little season. The trials, the problems in life will only last for a brief moment. For a brief moment. Then they're going to get better. It's going to get better. Because everything that you and I go through as believers will be purified unto precious gold. And what does that mean? We'll talk about that in just a few moments. But let's look at a couple of words here with me real quickly. About three words that we should notice here in these two verses in chapter 1, 6 and 7. Look at them. First of all, he says, you're in heaviness through mindful temptations, right? And in the next verse, he says that the trial of your faith, there's a trial and there's temptation. The Greek text can mean either or the other, either one in the Greek text. Temptations or trials can have a positive or negative connotation to them, depending on the context in which they're used. In life, we all face some kind of a test, because trials, in essence, is a test. But test comes, and these trials are tests, and these temptations are testing us. It can have two results. We can pass it because God has sent the test to prove who we are and that we are learning from Him. Or we can fail it because Satan will also bring about temptation through the test. Hello? To lure you away from God. So, what are you saying, preacher? When trouble comes, remember it's a test. Pass or fail, right? How are we going to know if we're passing or failing? Have you ever had the test and you become bitter, or did you pray? Well, what's the use of me going to church? All this stuff happened to me. See, you got bitter. Hello? The Bible tells us to take everything to God in prayer. When we take it to God in prayer, we have a different perspective on the task. Hello? Matter of fact, amen, when I learned my valuable lesson, instead of failing the test and pass the test, great joy came. Great joy came. Out of my whole high school years, up to the 11th grade, I failed. Then I quit school. It's because you can quit. And I say this because many times we quit on God through all of it. When we fail over and over again, we just quit on God altogether. Same way with me in high school. I was going to quit, and I quit in the 10th grade, and I went on my merry way. You know, I was going to get me a job. I'm going to be productive. You know, I'm going to do other things. You know, I got tired of failing those tests. But thank God, God has a person that's always there to encourage you. God had a person to encourage me to go back to school, finish my last 2 years, and graduate. And through the whole process, to make a long story short, I learned what it was, amen, to apply myself and learn. And then the last 2 years made honor roll. Boy, I'm very proud of that. Honor roll. And that's the same way in life. See, God, amen, don't want you to quit and throw in the towels. He wants you to bring it to Him in prayer because He wants to see you pass, amen, with honor. Woo! Glory to God. Amen. I'm going to have a church if I got to have it by myself. Amen. I'm into this thing. Amen. Some of you are just playing Christian, but praise God, I tell you, it's time to quit playing and get serious. Because life is complicated. And it's going to take Jesus to get you through. It's going to take Jesus to get you through. So when the tests come, we may turn to God in prayer. We may become bitter. We may become quiet and thoughtful, or we may begin to complain. We may become tender and compassionate, or we may become harsh and cruel. We may learn to trust in God, or we may rebel against Him. It's our choice. It's our choice whether we pass or whether we fail. It's on you. We can take courage, or we may give in to fear. We might draw closer to God, or we may turn away from Him. It's all up to you. But I'm like old Joshua. For me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. Because trials or temptation may have different results, but it all depends on how you respond. Verse 6 begins with a phrase wherein he greatly rejoiced. Right? Wherein he greatly rejoiced. Y'all with me? Chapter 1, verse 6, right there. Wherein he greatly rejoiced. How can you rejoice when things are going wrong in your life? Take the root word of joy. Consider it for a moment. What is joy? What is joy? This is a difficult word to define. We know that joy and happiness are two different things. You stay with me. Happiness depends on the circumstances, and it comes and goes depending on the emotion of the moment. Happiness depends on the circumstances and comes and goes depending on the emotion of the moment. But joy is a deeper and more profound because it comes not from within you, but from God. I like to do joy like this: Jesus, others, and yourself. If you put God first, then you have God's perspective on all things. And with God's perspective on all things, you know they're only brief, they only last for a moment, because joy comes in the morning. Amen? Joy comes in the morning. Joy comes from the satisfaction with God. When we are satisfied with God, we have joy. Even in the hardest moments of our life, we have joy. Now, I've seen saints of God, amen, who have dedicated their lives to God, knows exactly what the scripture is talking about. Even in their difficult times, they had joy knowing that God was in control because they were satisfied with God and God was satisfied with them. First thing I learned, amen, is from these verses right here in chapter 1, that trials are short-lived. They're short-lived. Peter began by assuring his readers, hey, the trials or the temptation in your life, it only lasts for a season, for a little while, for a little while. He didn't promise you that you will have a bed of roses here. But hang on, hang on, hang on, joy comes in the morning. We all understand that it might seem like forever. Especially when you're sitting beside the bedside of a loved one who is fixing to leave this world. Or when that sickness is upon you and you can't seem to lift your head up. It seems like forever. You see, our trials may last for weeks or months or years, and sometimes it may last for decades. But seen against the endless ages of eternity, it's only a fleeting moment. Brief by comparison. But see, our problem is a kind of a spiritual nearsighted that views the world as the real world. We view this world as the real world. It's not. We're just passing through. In essence, James said, your life is even a brief moment. He said, it's like a vapor that appears for a little time and then it's gone. You know, if you think about it today, if you're young, amen, you don't think about those things, but 10 to 20 years from now, you're going to look back on your life if you, Lord allows you to live that long, and you'll say, what a short time. What a short time. What a short time. So in light of eternity, life here is short and we're just passing through. This is not the real world. The real world is yet to come. what is this all saying then to us? That trials not only is for a moment, but it helps to identify us. Number two, identify us. Reveals our identity. Back over in chapter 4 and verse 13 there, it says this. If he be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. Well, what does that mean, really? It's saying, hey, the trials is necessary to reveal what's in your heart. And what's in your heart, amen, should be Jesus Christ. And if Jesus Christ in your heart, he will be glorified in your life through the difficult times of your life, that, amen, he may receive honor and glory. So it's Jesus shining in you. Let your little light shine. We all sung that little song, amen. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Well, your light shines the brightest in the darkest moments of your life. It's short-lived. It reveals the identity, amen, who I'm identifying with, who's in my life. And number three, it's for my purification. Amen. Sanctification comes through the Holy Spirit. It's a purifying event. That's what the fire is about. Fire purifies. Now, what's that got to do with us? If God puts us through the fire to purify us, just like that goldsmith does for that gold, in the end result, we should be able to see the reflection of him within us. That's only purification we got is in Jesus Christ. Our sanctification is by Jesus Christ, his righteousness. Because our righteousness compared to his, Isaiah said, is as filthy rags. So when Christ puts us through the trials and the persecutions of life, he is purifying us to reflect him. Because it is through him that we're able to get through it. It's through him that we're able to get through it. Somebody say amen. Amen. We cannot do it on our own. And so we know that trials come. They're short-lived. They reveal the identity of who we serve. And they'll dare to purify us, makes our faith stronger. And it reflects Jesus Christ because it has eternal significance. Fourth thing.